In this video, we're computing an indefinite integral of a big rational function. So what we're hoping to do is apply partial fractions decomposition to this thing. A couple notes before we start. First, the degree of the numerator is less than the degree of the denominator. So this is already in its proper form. We don't have to use long division to transform it. And second, our denominator is cubic. Now, cubic denominators can often be really hard to factor, but this one has a special symmetry that we're going to take advantage of. So again, the goal is to factor the denominator and then make a partial fractions decomposition proposal. In other words, a proposal of how to break it into smaller fractions. And to get that done, we need the factored form of the denominator. And this one is very nicely set up to use factoring by grouping. In other words, if I look at the first two terms and the second two terms, I see the potential here to have a common binomial factor. So what I'm going to do is just take the greatest common factor out of the first pair of terms, that's x squared. And I can rewrite that as x squared distributed over x minus 3. And then I realize my second two terms is just x minus 3. So I could write that as a 1 times the quantity x minus 3. So now the x minus 3 can be factored out of those two terms. So that saves us all the work of trying to use the root guessing method for factoring a cubic polynomial. This one happened to work by grouping, and it's probably worth looking for that at the beginning of a problem like this. So my denominator factors into x minus 3 times the quantity x squared plus 1. The x squared plus 1 there is an irreducible quadratic, so we'll have to follow the usual rules for our partial fractions decomposition proposal. And that proposal looks like this. Our first factor is just an ordinary linear factor. So I'm going to put in our partial fractions decomposition proposal an a over x minus 3. And then our second factor is an irreducible quadratic. So to be general enough for this to be guaranteed to work, I need to put a general linear function in that numerator. So I end up with a bx plus c over x squared plus 1. And then the whole game is to determine the a, b, and c algebraically. And that means our integrand will break down to these two simpler pieces, and we should be able to find quick antiderivatives of all the pieces. So we start out in the usual way by multiplying by the least common denominator on both sides. So that's just the entire original denominator, x minus 3 times x squared plus 1. And that's going to cancel all the denominators in the problem. So on the left side, we're just left with a 5x squared plus 11x plus 9. And on the right side, when we distribute x minus 3 times x squared plus 1 to the a containing term, the x minus 3s are going to cancel. And that leaves me with an a times the quantity x squared plus 1. In our second fraction, that had a numerator of bx plus c. And when I distribute this least common denominator to that term, the x squared plus 1 cancels, leaving me with an x minus 3. Now we need to generate a system of equations for a, b, and c. And I'm going to take the approach this time of just organizing the right-hand side in descending order. So I want to write it as a series of coefficients multiplying the highest power of x, the next highest power of x, all the way down to the constants. Now with a little bit of practice, the bookkeeping can get pretty efficient on this. I can see immediately the highest power of x on the right-hand side is x squared. So I start just looking at all the different ways that I can get x squared. Well, in this first term, I can get an ax squared. So there's one of those. And then over here, I can get a bx squared. So if I wrote down the right-hand side in an expanded form, I would have an ax squared plus a bx squared. In other words, an a plus b times x squared. And now we start looking for all the ways we could get a linear term. In other words, an x to the first power. Well, this a containing term isn't going to give us a linear term. And then in our second piece, the b times negative 3, that gives us a negative 3bx. And then the c times x gives us a cx. When we factor that, we end up with negative 3b plus c times x. Finally, we look for all the constants. There's an a times 1, in other words, just a, and then a c times negative 3, so negative 3c. So my constant piece is just a minus 3c. So this whole thing started with the assumption that this rational function, 5x squared plus 11x plus 9 over x minus 3 times x squared plus 1, could be written as two simpler rational functions added together. And the point I'm trying to make here is that we're not trying to find like a specific value of x that makes this equation true down here. What we're saying is these two functions on the left and right hand sides are literally equal functions for every value of x. The only way that happens is if every coefficient of the different powers of x is equal. So that's the reasoning we use to generate our system of equations. I'm saying that a plus b better equal 5 in order for these two functions on the left and right hand sides to be equal. So I'm going to leave a little extra space here just so we can align all these equations. So I have a plus b is equal to 5. And then in our second equation, we'll look at the linear terms. The coefficient of x on the left better be the same as the coefficient of x on the right. So I end up with a negative 3b plus c is equal to 11. Finally, we compare the constants on the left and right hand side, and then I have an a minus 3c is equal to 9. Now you can use your favorite method to solve this system of three equations and three unknowns. You could even get really sophisticated and write everything in matrix form if you know some of those tricks, but I'm just going to use a little bit of elimination and then substitution. So the first thing that occurs to me is let's go ahead and multiply the top equation by 3 and then add to the middle equation. So the reason I did that is because when I multiply the top equation by 3, getting a 3a plus 3b equals 15, and I add to the middle equation, the 3b and the negative 3b are going to cancel. So making that elimination produces a new equation, and that's 3a. Again, the b term cancels, and then I have a plus c from the second equation. And then on the right-hand side of my modified first equation, that was a 15. If I add that to 11, I get 26. And the reason this matters is because I've just produced a second equation that only has an a and a c in it. Now I can combine that with our third original equation. So let's take a look at this system. 3a plus c is equal to 26. And then this original third equation is a minus 3c equals 9. So I can use elimination again on this guy. I can just multiply the first equation by 3 and then add to the bottom equation. So that gives me a 9a plus another a, that's 10a. And then I did this specifically to eliminate the c containing term. I have a 3c minus 3c, which is 0. And then I have a 3 times 26 plus 9. And that comes out to 87. So now we're able to solve for a, and we have our first coefficient. So we're just going to leave that as 87 over 10. All right, next I'm going to go ahead and find b, because this first equation up here is really simple and has only a and b in it. So b is going to be 5 minus a, and I'll get a common denominator as I'm working here. A has a denominator of 10, so I'm going to write 5 as 50 over 10. So I have 50 over 10 minus 87 over 10, and that means b is negative 37 over 10. So now it looks like the easiest way to find c is to just use this second equation. C is going to be 11 plus 3b. So again, we're going to have a denominator of 10 in that b term. So I'm going to write 11 as 110 divided by 10. And then we have minus because b is negative. So minus 3 times 37 over 10. Well, 3 times 37 is 111. So I have minus 111 over 10. So in the end, I find that c is equal to negative 1 over 10. All right, so we found the A, B, and C from the partial fractions decomposition proposal that we started with. And that means we can rewrite our integrand in these simpler pieces. So my integral turns into the integral of A over X minus 3. And I'm going to go ahead and break the second one into two pieces. That's Bx over X squared plus 1 plus a C over X squared plus 1. Both of those integrate in different ways, so we may as well split them up right now. So for the Bx term, I have a negative and then 37 tenths x up there in the numerator. Or you could pull the 37 tenths out in front, it doesn't matter. And my denominator is an x squared plus 1. And then for the c term, I have, again, a negative and a 1 tenth in my numerator. And then in the denominator, I have an x squared plus 1. And the whole point of partial fractions decomposition is that all of these smaller pieces are really quick integrals. So this first piece, 87 tenths over x minus 3, the 87 tenths is just a spectator there. So I'll pull that out in front, 87 tenths. And then the integral of 1 over x minus 3 is the natural log absolute value x minus 3. Now my second piece requires a little bit of adjustment. I almost have the derivative of the denominator sitting in the numerator. And remember, whenever I have the derivative of the denominator in the numerator, that's a consequence of differentiating the natural log of the denominator. And that derivative in the numerator is just a consequence of the chain rule. So the derivative of the denominator is actually a 2x. And to get that factor of 2 attached to the x, we have to multiply by 1/2 out in front. This gives me a negative 37 over 20. And I guess I'll just write this integral explicitly one more time before we write the final answer. Times 2x over x squared plus 1 dx. So we'll just do that in the next step. And then my last piece, if I just pull the negative 1/10 out of it, is the integral of 1 over 1 plus x squared, which is exactly the formula for derivative of the inverse tangent function. So that integrates to the inverse tangent. And I put my plus c there at the end. Now just computing this final integral. Again, what I did there was force this integrand into a form where the derivative of the denominator appeared in the numerator. That allows me to recognize this as the derivative of a natural log function. So that's the natural log of the denominator. And when I check that with the chain rule, it's just 1 over the argument of the log function. So 1 over x squared plus 1 times the derivative of that argument, which is a 2x. All right, this last term is a spectator, and our plus c is a spectator. And that's our final answer. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.